Welcome to Romera Records virtual cast. Today we have on April McGlitchy-Wall. How's it going?
Hi, good to see you.
Yeah, so you're actually my instructor in my data analysis and reporting class. For everybody who doesn't know, I'm going to Full Sail University for a music business, and I decided to ask April on because her class is pretty interesting. I hadn't had a class like that, which, like, you know, it applied some things that everybody should know how to do, which was like Excel.
Right.
So I actually have a day job. I'm a full-time with Owens Corning, like the shingle manufacturer. Basically what I do there is automation. So I'm an automation technician, and I had to do a RCA on just like Excel. It was just like a setup. It's already set up, and all I had to do is just fill stuff out. And my boss was telling me how to do something. I was like, oh, I already knew how to do that, because I had it was just like merging cells or something like
that. Right.
I was like, oh, snap, that was applicable.
Yay! That's definitely what we hope for sure. And it's so hard because there's only a month for anyone who knows about Full Sail's curriculum. You know, it's 1 month to get a lot of content of what would normally be a full semester. And with our class, you know, focusing on Excel, it's like Excel is a big program. It's really hard to just squeeze it all into 1 month. So it's more about exploring. And so I'm glad to hear that you were able to implement some of the concepts immediately. You know, I get such a variety where some people say they have experience and they've been using it for years and years, and then other people have never touched the program. And so it's always a fine balance on that.
Yeah. I mean, so there's a guy who just started working with me. He's got the same job as I do, and he's actually always been a Mac person. And, but the only computers we have are Windows type computers. Mm. So it's kind of funny because, like, I need to help him with certain stuff, and it's just, you know, I'm so glad that Full Sail uses Macs, though, because it's such a, I think it's easy. There's so many, I guess, complicated things you can get with, like, using Windows, but Mac is, like, universal. So it's pretty cool being able to, you know, help out people with just, like, a project like Excel or whatever, because those tools, like, you know, I guess people don't really understand it if they're younger, say, because I'm 28. Mm-hmm. I've already graduated from Jacksonville State University in Alabama, but they probably won't understand that, like, the younger people who are like 18, 19, they won't understand it till they get out of school.
You'd be surprised, though. One thing that I have found over the years, because I've been with Full Sail about 10 years now, I guess going on 11, and sometimes the older students actually have a lot more software knowledge. And sometimes that surprises me, but there are people that they just haven't had exposure to it, haven't had to use different softwares, and not just Excel, but sometimes students come in and they're deathly afraid of the computer. And often that'll surprise me, especially if they're an online student, because I would think, oh, but you know, that's what you do. You're online, you're with the computer, but everybody just has different comfort levels. And so it's just a matter of trying to learn how people learn best, and then to try and work with that where possible when they reach out. But when you were mentioning the Windows and Mac, you know, I used to be a Windows person through most of my life growing up. I never had a Mac or anything. Plus, you know, it was relatively new back in the 80s. But once I got into the entertainment industry and I started using a Mac, I haven't gone back. You know, it's something that people become Mac people or not, and definitely can get you hooked, especially because it doesn't seem to be, you know, hopefully I'm knocking on wood for this, but like viruses and stuff in the same way that it seems to hit the PC users. And, you know, I just find it friendly. And when you mentioned Excel earlier, and I thought about the connection with Mac, one thing that I think has been really interesting with Microsoft in these last, I'd say 5 to 10 years, is Mac is finally catching up. You know, Mac used to always be the stepchild, per se, of Windows. When it came to Excel, it was always 3 to 5 years behind it seemed whatever you could do on a Windows computer. And now it's almost interchangeable. And that's, I think it's come a long way. And I think people can appreciate Apple computers a little bit more than they did back in the past.
I mean, my big cliche quote that I love to tell people is, it's not about who did it first, but who did it best. And
true.
Apple to the T. Like, they're never the first people to do stuff. I mean, there's some things where they're the first, but like when it comes to like universally used things, they're usually not the first, but they just do it the best. Like,
right.
They didn't create Bluetooth, but they thought of AirDrop, and they just made their own name for it. And then it's so widely used, and everybody's like, oh, just AirDrop it to me. And nobody says, hey, Bluetooth that to me.
Right, exactly.
You know, exactly. Apple, you know, they might have been behind in some of the like Excel or whatever. They end up implementing things better. So I think mm-hmm. that really has a gives them a leg up on most of their competition when in any kind of software stuff.
Right.
Is there something that you have really picked up from the class that you're doing? And actually, first off, is that the only class you teach?
At the moment, yes. When I first started Full Sail back in 2010, I started by teaching the accounting class. So it was called financial accounting, I believe, at the time. It's morphed over the years. But I started as what's called an associate course director, and I only did online accounting classes. And then about a year or so later, in essence, I got promoted, and they moved me into the class that you had now, but it's called data analysis and reporting. And ultimately, you know, what I tried to do, because this is a sophomore level class, and so I try to give a little bit of business foundation, but ultimately it's teaching the software right now, because we have learned again over the years, so many people actually haven't even touched the program, that it's more getting familiar with what does this thing do, you know, what is a spreadsheet, and then how can you manipulate it. So I'm not sure if that answered your question, but ultimately, at first I started in accounting, and then I moved into this class. So, and it was very different teaching mid-program, where I was teaching a junior level class, to then being towards the beginning of the program, where usually I'm month 6 or 8 now. And it is interesting to see people still haven't gotten into the flow of necessarily when assignments are due and things. And so it's a different dynamic, but rewarding all the same, because usually people are more energized earlier in the program than they are a little bit later.
Yeah, they get that senior slump.
Right, exactly. We've all been there. You said you had a degree before this too, so I'm sure you can appreciate that.
So so the other question I was going to ask you is there something that you get out of the class that like makes you, I guess, just realize, I guess, how things are changing? Like, you know, you're giving everybody the tools to be successful when they get out of school, but I'm sure it's making you realize, I guess, how things change for people in the industry when they get out as you continue to teach.
Right. And I would say that generations seem to change, you know, that everybody has different skill sets and different approaches to schooling. And so it has been interesting to see, I find, and this is only my experience, but that students in these most recent years have been much more engaged and much more interested and caring about the materials, actually wanting to learn it instead of just, quote, getting the degree. You know, that there is, that's one change I've seen over time, that students right now really seem to have a passion and a drive to fully appreciate how each subject matter can relate to them. Because it's not always just about work. You know, sometimes you can implement concepts from the classes in your everyday life. And that's always really rewarding, you know. And I didn't know if you were going to ask this, but one of the things that's my favorite part of the job is hearing that aha moment, you know, for that student that's really struggling and just doesn't get it. I like to think that it's, if I tried to do Adobe Illustrator, which I've attempted and I'm not very good at all. And so, and I was in tears because I took a whole month class on Adobe Illustrator, and I thought, oh, this is what my students feel about my class sometimes, which is hard for me to imagine because I just think it's the best thing ever. You know, teaching Excel is so much fun. But then I try and have that perspective. And the best part of this type of job is when you get those students who either love it and take it to the next level or have struggled with it. And then by the end of the month, really get it. And having that, you know, literally it's, oh, when you hear that noise, that's the best ever.
I think the craziest thing is like, when you're trying to do something, so if you gave us an assignment and we're, you know, you give us the videos and it's step by step, but then when we try to do it, it's like, how come that doesn't look the same thing?
Exactly.
That's probably the funniest part, because it's like, even though I just watched somebody else do this, it's not working mm-hmm. for me. And then you exactly. have to. Moment like, oh, I was supposed to click here and not there or something like that.
And that one stupid little comma makes all the difference. That's one thing that's hard about tutorial-based learning is that it's very precise. And so as the learner, if you don't do it in the exact way that the tutorial's showing, and it's so easy to make a typo and such, it's difficult to move forward because then you're just stuck and it's like, oh, what did I just do? I have no idea. As opposed to, you know, some theory learning where you're just learning broad concepts, then sometimes you can interpret it different and it's not as bad, I guess. I do sympathize, I guess, empathy, if I put it in an illustrator perspective. But I do sympathize when it's just that one little thing that could make all the difference, just that one click. And yeah.
Yeah, I had some experience with Excel before, and, you know, but it's just very basic things. But taking that class really, I guess, just open my mind to like the possibilities of like what you can do in Excel. Like, I'll have certain things I have to do in my job. And when I had after the class and I'm just doing these certain things, I'm like, oh man, that was so useful. I'm like, oh, now I get, you know, how that was put together and how to do that kind of stuff. So I think more schools should really implement these very particular type skills, because, you know, that's what's going to set you apart from being average and then above average when you finally get a job.
Right. And with your experience, I believe you had mentioned that you were in a job that primarily was data entry on a spreadsheet already developed. Did you, because you were a superstar student, I know that as well, you know, did you find that you wanted to learn how to create it, or is it more understanding the concepts in the background? Like, if you had the ability to create some type of technology class like this, what do you think would be the most useful based on both your experience academically as well as your experience out there in your current job? What do you feel would help the most?
I think just being able to like understand those different types of like templates and stuff like that. So there'll be like certain setups that I'll see at work and I'm just like, how did they put that together? And so
right.
to know, what do they call it? Like the, I guess like the backplane or however, you know, just knowing how everything got put together and being able to start from scratch with it, that I think right. that would completely change like how somebody, I guess, thinks at work. Because if you've got a particular document, and let's say, you know, let's say it got lost, like my job, we have like a shared drive to where everybody at our plant is able to connect with each other and use one folder. So let's say somebody accidentally deleted like the master template to something. There was one person who just so happens to know how to create that template, then that would completely be a game changer for the company. So
right.
those simple steps of like, so when we were doing the, I guess it was like the ticket sales, mm-hmm. had like the names of the companies or the bands or whatever,
yep.
and being able to organize those. Like, if you just knew, you know, how to make sure to set those up and then be able to transfer that data over, like, that helps out tremendously.
Right. Okay. Well, that's good to know, because I'm always curious of other people's perspectives on it. Because one thing I feel, because I've literally been doing spreadsheets since elementary school. So I always enjoy hearing other people's perspectives, because some of the stuff I take for granted, not thinking, what would it be like if I just came into this right now? How would I feel about it? What would I want to learn? So that's why I was curious, especially since you're in the circumstance where you have a mix of experience as well as, you know, just going through the program. So,
yeah, have you ever used OneNote, Microsoft OneNote?
I have not. I don't know too much about it, so I'd love to hear more on it, but no, I haven't used it.
OneNote is probably the most underrated app there is. Like,
yeah.
Period. So, you know, like when you're in Microsoft Word and you type and then you wish you could just like move the cursor and click and just type wherever you want to. You can do that in OneNote.
It's okay.
Literally set up like a literal notebook. So, you know, have like notebooks will have like the tan color dividers in them. That's how OneNote is set up. So it's like one program that you can create tabs at the top. And then in that tab, you can have pages. So on the like the you can put them, I guess, on the left or right hand side, wherever you want. But at the top, it'll have tabs. And then on the like right side, it'll have like a page. So you can create a page. So let's say for school, my notebook could be called Full Sail University.
Right. And
at the top, I would have my different tabs, and those tabs would be my classes. And my my pages on the right hand side could be each week. And then I would just, you know, put in all my homework for that week and like take notes or whatever. And then when I'm done with that week, I would just create another page on the right hand side. And then boom, now I could go to that page and look at all my notes I took for the second week.
Super
useful. And you can like, you can put videos in there. You can put pictures. You can highlight. You can do customized point arrows, like all kinds of stuff. But it's just one of those things that I think it's so complicated. Like there's so much stuff you can do that people don't understand it. So they just don't use it.
Right.
I don't know if you ever heard the phrase, a confused mind says no. So that's pretty much what it is. Like people just get confused about it. So they're just like, never mind. That's how, what is that app called? It was Google.
I was thinking Evernote.
No, Google had something where they just canceled it. Like, they were, it was kind of like a Google Plus. That's what it was.
Oh, okay. I thought that was more a social media type thing.
Well,
it was organizing.
Yeah, it was, but it was just the fact that like Google Plus was super useful. Nobody used it though. Because they just didn't understand it. I think it was one of those things. It was just ahead of its time and nobody got it. So they ended up getting rid of it. I think it was sometime last year or 2 years ago or something like
that.
And it was just because they put a lot of work into it, but nobody used it. So being able to just like understand something and having it useful, AKA Apple and Mac.
Right.
Why they're so successful, because people can just pick it up and just start using it. Like if you can't, then it's not going to be too helpful.
Yeah, one of the things I want to compliment you on, just hearing it from your conversation here, and I think the world needs to be like this, but the fact that you organize everything academically, you know, in OneNote, and you have that whole procedure, that is something that does surprise me month after month, that I do see a lot of people do not have their own organization systems. And so I think, you know, providing that tip is fantastic, you know, because in at Full Sail, as instructors, we have to teach kind of a seminar, I guess you could say, each year. And the one I do is on organization, because I see month after month, you know, I call it a mosaic on the desktop when there are just icons everywhere and you can't find anything. I was like, okay, let's start by setting up a class file folder. And then this is how you can make a shortcut to those file folders. And it sounds like, and I'm sorry, I am backtracking just a little bit. But with OneNote, I also went to accelerated degree, my original bachelor's with the University of Phoenix. And then I also did one of the Full Sail masters. And an accelerated program moves so fast and it's so hard to retain the content. So what you just described with OneNote sounds awesome, because at least in the entertainment and music business programs, I think we have 4 marketing classes or something. There's quite a few marketing classes. And so as you get deeper into the program, it sounds like you could just go to your notebook, pull up your intro to marketing, and have that just easily accessible to kind of refresh yourself for when you do hit that next marketing class, even if it's 2 months from now when you've already had six subjects in between, you know, or something like that.
Yeah, that's what I do at work. So, you know, I work with PLCs and a lot of like automated type things. So if we ever have like a trouble, like a problem with like, I don't know, let's say we have a gauge. So we're reading feet in a tank or something like that. Well, I'll just go to my OneNote and I have a tab at the top that's labeled, I don't know, like work issues or something like that. Uh-huh. So problem at work, I'll go to that tab and then I'll create a page on the right side that is like, let's say it's tank one. So I'll just click on tank one and then put, we were working on tank one. We had an issue with blah, 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 blah. And then I'll put a, I'll take a picture on my phone, send it to my computer. And then I'm like, this is what happened. Like, this is the thing.
Exactly.
And boom, and it just say, that's another great thing about OneNote is it saves itself. So you, mm-hmm. Hitting Control S does nothing because it's like constantly saving itself,
right?
Which we all have forgotten.
Exactly. No. I teach on campus as well, and the students that see me in the hall later just say save check. They don't necessarily remember my name, but I say save check all the time in class. So, and one more thing on the organization, the auto saving, what you just remind me of when you have issues at work, I use a software called OmniFocus, and I call it a to-do list on steroids because there's a lot of different ways you can organize and such. And it is expensive, but worth every penny. I invested in it, I guess, about 5 or 6 years now. And what's cool about that program, which it sounds like OneNote could do, so you have to tell me on this, but that you can set up a to-do list or some kind of date for 10 years from now, and it still will show up ready to go. Like, I have my warranties logged. I have, you know, problems that have come up. And sure enough, there was a home event, you know, for me where I need to be reminded in 2021 that XYZ was going to happen. And January 1st, it was like, oh, I totally forgot about that. So it's, if you can have some kind of organization system like that, it's awesome because then you don't have to constantly stress about what you have to do and where you need to be and where you need to go, because it all comes up at you. Now, does OneNote provide that? Does it also have a calendaring function, or is it more just for notebook purposes?
I'm not sure. It might be able to. It has a lot of features that, like, so, you know, when you like click on a new app that you haven't used before and it gives you like this short tutorial of stuff.
Right.
I was helping somebody else set up their OneNote and it was going through the tutorial and I was like, oh, I didn't know you could do that. So it probably has a lot of features that I've never even used before just because I haven't had to. But right. It might have like some calendar, to-do list type stuff on there. I have to check it out. But you said OmniFocus was...
Oh, yeah, OmniFocus. It's Mac specific. So they're just now moving into the ability on a Windows platform. It's a limited version that's a web version of the software. But yeah, it's called OmniFocus. It's a little purple check. It's based off David Allen's Getting Things Done. I don't know if you've had the chance to listen to or read that book, but definitely one that's great for organization and learning techniques to get your priorities straight, so to speak. It was really inspiring for me. I listened to it back in 2000, I think, because I don't read. I'm an audiobook kind of girl, but changed my life completely. And then eventually that ended up getting me into OmniFocus. So Okay. Yeah, it's pretty cool.
Cool. So for when you started at Full Sail, do they have any like set requirements for you to be an instructor there? Like, I mean, even at, you know, any other like university, I'm sure not everybody is like a doctor. I don't think you have to be a doctor to like teach a class, right?
You do not. I think you need a doctorate in some of the master's degrees programs. I think that it's a requirement on the general education information and the master's. I'm not 100% sure on that. A master's is recommended. I don't know that it's required. I don't think so at the moment, but the real critical part is also having 5 years of experience in whatever that you're teaching, 5 years of entertainment experience specifically. And so you definitely have to have the college degree. I've actually had people ask that. So yeah, so you do have to have the bachelor's, and then master's is preferred. And then doctorate, I think, is only if you're teaching certain classes in the master's programs. So, but of course, when you're in the master's program, it's encouraged that you have the doctorate and such. So
when you, I guess when you like, when you start in Full Sail, is there like a certain class you were just like, I wanted to do this, or did you just kind of like, oh, they have this available and I will teach it? So,
well, yeah, I actually, how I fell into this, and I say fell into this job because I was originally intending to teach in retirement. You know, that's what my parents did, is after they had a full blown career, you know, then they ultimately, when they retired, they started teaching. And I was like, that sounds great. And accounting was always my background. Well, I shouldn't say always, because I had a very skewed past to get where I'm at. That's one advice I have for everybody. Take any job, even if it's not your perfect job right up front, because you never know where it's going to lead you. But anyway, accounting, once I was in my full adult career, I was in small business accounting and did primarily bookkeeping, financial statements and such. And then in 2010, I guess it was, I had lost that job. And so I was kind of at a real crossroads in my life. You know, I just started a relationship with my now husband, and it was just a, what am I going to do? And it kind of took a step back, and I thought, well, I always wanted to teach, so let me look and see if there's any teaching jobs out there. And so I looked into that, and then I saw with Full Sail an accounting teacher. I'm like, how is that possible? You know, and also now that I have been in this position for so long, that was kind of a one in a million chance. It's that everything happens for a reason, because, you know, currently in in the entertainment business and music business bachelor's, there's only one accounting class, you know, so that is one to five teachers that, you know, depending on their course, that teach it. And the fact that that position happened to open when I happened to be looking for a new career, and it was just, it was amazing. So when I saw the job, I wanted the job. Like, as soon as I saw that, I thought that was everything I was absolutely looking for. And I was a little nervous because I hadn't taught before, you know, in my prior experience, because I also did human resources. I did do a lot of training, and I was a manager. So I did training, you know, in that job too. And I always felt that was something I enjoyed doing, but I didn't know if people thought I was good at it, you know, because most people don't tell their boss if they don't like the way they train, you know, and such. So I was a little nervous, and I probably fumbled a little bit my first few months, but then kind of got the hang of it. And when I moved into the Excel class, one thing, I didn't think anything was going to get better than teaching accounting. I really thought that was, I just got my dream job, life is great. Then they said, well, we're going to have you teach this class. And I was like, but I love teaching accounting. No, I love teaching Excel. it amazed me how much more engaged students were in this class as opposed to accounting. Because I'm not sure, you know, how you feel about accounting, but a lot of people are of the mindset of, I'll just pay somebody for that. You know, I don't want to do that, so I'm just going to pay somebody for that. And so therefore, they're not as interested in learning the topic. And then there's also a big push as an accounting teacher, when you're trying to get students involved, is that you try and explain it's not the math, you know, because one thing about accounting is it's terminology. When you're at the basic level, it really is just terminology. So anyway, I feel like a tangent a little bit, I love the job, and I'm so glad I got into it. And it was all things meant to be when that happened in 2010, for sure.
So you were talking about doing retirement, and it's kind of funny because you are in the state that everybody retires to.
Right.
I would assume that would actually be an amazing business right there, is being in Florida and like helping people with money. Cause a lot of people, like, there are people who have a lot of money that aren't good with money, which is really crazy. How did you get all this money? But sometimes people are great with money, but don't have a lot of money, and you know, whatever job they're working, you know, they can save, and they just, you know, don't really know. I mean, can't really accumulate, but they know what to do with it when they get it. So you find that that's something outside of teaching, that's something that you would like to do, is help people, you know, with their money in that aspect?
Not as much, because it sounds like what you're describing is more on the personal finance level. And that was an area that I never understood as well, as accounting is more record keeping and projections for businesses. So it's not as much in the individual, which is what it sounded like more where you were talking. So I haven't really had an interest in being in the personal finance side of things. I think it's an interesting subject. I really do, because simply to your point, you know, some people have money, don't know how to use it. Some people don't have any money and use it great. And then it's all a lot of in between. But I think that would be an industry I'd be a little scared of, because then if things go wrong, you know, if you give advice and things don't go the way that you anticipated based on the advice you gave, you have people really mad at you. So I think I'll prefer my warm squishies of teaching.
I was actually watching, it was on HBO Max. It was a documentary on Warren Buffett. And he was talking about, I think he said he did his taxes when he was like 14 or something like that, because he had his own, like, he would go door to door and sell Cokes to people and sell gum. And I think it was like candy bars and stuff like that. He's just been a business guy.
Right.
I thought that was very unique, because he was trying to explain to people, which he was in. They showed this one video of, he was in a classroom of, it might have been like high school seniors or something like that. And there's probably, I don't know, like 15 of them in there just like sitting around listening to him talk. And I was like, they have no idea how golden this information. They look so bored.
Right.
It was just funny, because like, that guy's at one point the richest man in the world, and he's just sitting in front of a bunch of, you know, 17-year-olds and just giving them free information, and they're probably not even
knowing what they have.
But I think it's very unique how, I guess, people's personal finances can be, there's just different ways you can do it, you know. I think that if people really paid attention to, I guess, how they can organize and do what they need to do for, you know, whatever, whether it's, you know, whether it's personal or a company. I think even my company, Owens Corning, like, I'll look around at the stuff we spend money on, I'm just like, why are we spending money on that?
Spoken like a true entrepreneur.
it just bothers me. Like, I'll see certain things, I'm just like, there's so many other things we could spend money on that I think would help out the company, but I don't know. It's not my money. And, you know, there's probably somebody else who sees a bigger picture, but I don't know.
Well, and you know, that's always the fine line, especially if you have multiple owners and such too, where there are differing opinions on how to spend the money, because there are some who are risk adverse, some that are willing to throw caution to the wind. And that's always a challenge in business, to figure out, what are you going to do with this money? You know, do you reinvest it back to the company? Do you give out bonuses instead? And those are always such tough decisions, to balance employee morale as well as the growth of the company and having all that come together. So,
yeah. So what would you say is like your, I don't know, either your specialty or your like favorite part about understanding how, I guess, the music industry or the entertainment industry, how it functions, like how people are moving along with their money and how, I guess, companies deal with their finances?
Yeah, I don't know that I have any specialties necessarily, because I'm more on the ground level aspect, in the sense where I consider more the specialty of the trying to teach the basics, you know, and giving a foundation more so than, I guess, the big picture. I don't know if that answers your question, but I really couldn't pinpoint any specific specialty like within the entertainment industry. I would say I'm more business specific focus, but at a very basic level, more that I feel it's important to share, you know, you have the quote, cool classes later, right? Artist management, and the ones that everybody is, that's why they're taking the degree, is to get those. And for me, I feel like, well, no, business is business. And so when I think of accounting, or when I think of my class, I think this is a foundation that, regardless of the industry, is important. And then you pull the content in of your subject matter, you know, whatever you're passionate about. And then you use that tool to your advantage. So I don't know, that's where I kind of consider it more of the below learning the foundation of business. That's kind of where I'd say more my talent lies, rather than the bigger entertainment industry itself. No. I don't know if that explains it.
No, yeah, you're good.
Okay.
So is there like a company that you have, that you've worked for, as like dealing with their specific, like, I guess, accounting in the industry or business industry?
Yeah. My background's quite varied, but the entertainment part of it, which is probably the part you care about more, I was in television production. So I did a lot of the behind the scenes financial work for what's called below the line crewing, which is people that run the camera ops, the camera operators, the audio engineers, the runners on the show and such. So I helped with the finances of that in a production company. And then I also, I don't know if you saw my, but I lived in Key West for 4 years. And so when I was in Key West, I did retail accounting. I've also done manufacturing accounting. So it's kind of been a little taste of everything. But I think my favorite was the entertainment job, because what I enjoyed about that, and it's a little bit of the pizzazz part of the entertainment industry, but seeing some of the stuff that I worked on or was a part of then on TV, because it was television based at that point. And, you know, hearing, because I worked near the design team, you know, the scenic and lighting people. And so when they would talk about their ideas and their concepts they wanted to bring to life, and then let's say they ask my opinion on something, and then to see that on TV after the fact was kind of a wow. And there was a lot of glamour in that, you know, but a lot of behind the scenes, a lot of rough work, long hours, very long hours, but worth it in the end. So
what TV stuff were you a part of?
Well, the boy, it's been a few years now. So there was NBC Poker After Dark. I'm trying to think of the phrase. Poker After Dark, Mansion Poker. That one, I don't know that was as much in the U.S. I think that was more broad. But Aussie Millions, it was mainly poker shows. That was kind of our bread and butter at the time. And also a little touch in the NASCAR, you know, Rolex 24, we did every year. We did a portion of that. And so trying to think of the names of them right now. Heads Up Poker, did I say that? I said Poker After Dark, but I didn't say NBC Heads Up Poker. Heads Up Poker is one we did every year too.
So are you doing all this from an office?
Yeah. Well, again, I only did the accounting side of it. There were people who were on site, you know, and doing the production. But yeah, what we did is we were the company that coordinated the on-site development, I guess you could say. So like when I mentioned the scenic and lighting department earlier, they would set up the set. They would decide, you know, does the poker table go here? What's the backdrop going to look like? How are we going to build this out and such? And I did the finances behind all that. So the, not as much like the calling to get the rentals and such, but the invoicing procedure, the reconciliations, which is always my favorite part of accounting, is doing the reconciliation. That's the one people hate the most, but it was always my favorite. And yeah, just developing budgets and then running the payroll for the independent contractors versus the people that were payrolled and stuff like that. So, but yeah, we had a small office. I think there was about 20 of us. So,
did you ever consider taking like, I guess another job that was within that area to, I don't know, maybe like help, or you wish you had, had a more entry level job and then, I guess, got the job you had? I don't know if that makes sense.
Actually, that's exactly how I got into the job I did. So, and that is probably, again, if I had to advise people in the world at all. One thing that I say when career searching is to not scoff at the entry-level jobs, because I had already had accounting experience before I had moved to Orlando. And so when I was looking at the different job opportunities available, I had gone through a temp agency, which is how I got almost all the jobs that actually made me money eventually. I started all of those in temp agencies. And so what I found, because I wasn't always confident in how to build my resume, but I found once I got into a job, I could show off my skills and then ultimately do well in the job. So I looked at this position. It was actually even part-time. It was just part-time accounting clerk, which is, you know, in the accounting field, very entry level. And I was like, oh, okay, I'll look at it and I'll consider it. And I met with the boss and he was pretty impressive. I liked him a lot. He knew his way around spreadsheets, which I didn't know a lot of people who knew that much about spreadsheets. His skills were very impressive. And I was like, well, this seems interesting. And, you know, and then we just got in there. Well, after just a couple months, it just seemed to blow up, you know, and it was a great circumstance, great people to work for. Again, the entertainment, the part of the entertainment industry I was in was very intense in the sense that there were very high expectations. You know, it was play hard and work hard, a lot of work hard, but then when you play hard. So it was a lot of fun in that regard too. But ultimately, that's what I had done is I started in a part-time position, and then it was within just a few months, they're like, okay, full-time, and then climb. So it was nice. But
yeah, I always think like those stories are really interesting when somebody says that, you know, oh, when I first started working here, I was, you know, mopping the floors and now I'm CEO.
Right. And that's, I fully went into it completely assuming it was going to be a temporary job. When I took the position itself, I thought, okay, a few months, you know, they're just looking for through a temp agency. And usually the people hiring with the temp agencies were kind of we just need you for a little bit and then you can move on. So I really went into the position thinking it was going to be part-time and just for a little while until I figured out whatever I was going to do. But then it turned out being the best job I had, I think.
So, that's awesome.
I mean, outside of what I'm doing now, because I absolutely love what I'm doing now.
So would you say that what you're doing now is like your ideal? Like if you could have been doing anything, like that's what you wanted to do is like just teach?
Hands down.
Okay.
Yep. Yeah, especially once I experienced it, you know, for anyone out there that might be interested in being a teacher, definitely try it because it is the most rewarding job. You know, it does have its frustrating moments and such, but I love it. Yeah, quite a bit. I wouldn't do anything else. I mean, except, like I said, reconciliation. If I could just be in spreadsheets and reconcile all day, that's kind of a dream job, but it's a very entry level. It wouldn't pay the bills kind of thing. But if I won the lottery, you know, I might do that. But this is second to that for sure.
Okay. So what is something that you would, I guess, want to change or edit about being an instructor for like a university? Because I'm sure there's certain, you know, there's only so much you can do, especially at Full Sail. It's so different. Like, you know, most schools you have, you know, 5-6 classes, you're full time, and that's for four months. You know, that's your whole
right.
school. With Full Sail, you know, you've got this one class, you do that for a whole month, then you're boom, on to the next thing, which is, I like it better. I like this. But what is something that you feel like, I don't know, I guess the university level kind of, I guess, it might limit you per se of like how you can help people, and I guess something that you think could just help people learn better?
Yeah, well, that's actually a tough question because it would be more, I'd need to ask other people how they feel I could better myself. The reason I say that is because Full Sail provides so much, in my opinion, so much freedom for us as course directors. You know, we do have to meet certain requirements, you know, to make sure certain subject matters are taught in our classes. However, there is a lot of flexibility as to how to deliver that content. For example, those tutorials that you dealt with in my class, those are 100% self-created. And so Full Sail gives that flexibility that they don't say you have to use this method to teach your subject. They allow the instructors to actually decide how to best deliver their curriculum. So in that respect, I wouldn't change anything, because I think that's better than if I taught it like UCF, where I imagine it's much more of a rigid structure. And not as much flexibility. But there was another question that you asked that I thought I could give a better answer to with that. But I wouldn't change anything with Full Sail. I'd say for my own learning, we have at Full Sail, as you probably already know, course critiques at the end of the month. And then what I do, we don't get those for a few months on what the students say, and they're anonymous. However, I read every single one, and I do my best to incorporate, you know, common themes that come up. But that goes back to Full Sail lets me do that. You know, if they see that there is, if I see something that's maybe a continuing problem in the class, oh, the videos were too long. Okay, so that I had gotten that feedback quite a bit. Videos were much too long. You know, they needed to be pulled back. Well, after you see that a few times, then it's like, oh, okay, I need to re-record my videos, have them 3 minutes or less, make the content in bite-sized pizzas. Yes, that means more videos, but it's in digestible format, you know, for somebody who's on the run and's got five kids and is trying to manage everything. And so that's one thing I do love about it, that I don't know if I would be as successful in another place, because I feel that Full Sail does allow for that creativity and that autonomy and stuff, that you can do what you need to do. But was there another part I didn't answer there? Because I felt like there was something else you said, and I was going to.
No, I mean, you pretty much answered it, because I think it's very interesting, like, just Full Sail's whole setup, because it was much different. Like, when I first found out about Full Sail, I was like, oh, I just have one class that I do for a whole month and I just move on. Like, that's perfect. Because, I mean, that's I would say my generation. As I said, I'm 28. So I think people who are my age and maybe a little older and definitely younger, short attention spans. So if you can just like, hey, do this thing and then you're done with it, that helps out tremendously, because you just get tired of doing the same thing. Like, especially if you're going to a physical class. So, you know, I'm online only, but if you're going to a physical class and you're like, oh, I've been doing this for like 3 months now, I'm tired of like, is the on campus, is it the same setup?
It is. And that's what I remembered as you just said it, the part I didn't answer that I wanted to, is that if I could truly change anything, I'd want them to be 6-week semesters instead of 4 weeks. I think 4 weeks, at least for my subject matter, is way too short. It just feels like you hit on a topic, and you can't go into anything in real depth. And for those that don't get the program, it's like 1 week, you have 1 week to catch up and understand it. And if you don't, you're struggling all month long. So I think 6-week classes would be ideal. But to answer your question regarding campus, yes, the campus students have the exact same schedule. The only difference, I think, is at spring break and summer break, you know, they have that Saturday, whereas the online students don't technically start it till Monday at midnight. But otherwise, it's the same class content, and it's just delivered in person, or of course now with all the COVID stuff, it's like I'm talking with you right now, that we do virtually. They're 4-hour classes, so it's 4 hours 3 days a week. And then for the campus students that are what's called immersive, meaning that they're taking two classes at once, so those students might have class 6 days a week on campus, depending on the month that they're in.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that's like when I was telling somebody during my in-person podcast about Full Sail, they were like, what? And I was like, yeah, like it's a way better setup. And like, even with the launch boxes where they're like, hey, you're paying us for school, so here's some stuff that it's going to help you.
Yes.
I was talking to somebody about that. I was like, every school should just like, you know, most people aren't paying for school like straight out of pocket. Most people are using student loans or scholarship money. So it wouldn't hurt if schools just added like an extra $2,000 or something like that to your tuition, and then like, oh yeah, by the way, here's your free laptop, and here's
give you the packet, right?
Here's free notebooks and pencils and all this stuff, and you know, people would be like, what? Why am I getting all this stuff?
Right. You actually bought it, by the way.
Exactly. Yeah. And which, you know, somebody that I was talking to mentioned this. They said, it's great that they're making the money decisions for you. Like, you don't have to decide, you know, with this money, do I go on spring break with this money that I have, or do I, you know, buy a laptop that I know I need. So they're taking the decision out of an 18, 19, 20 year old's hands and like, no, this is what you need. Like, use this. So I think that that's very useful that Full Sail does.
Yeah. The Launchbox is definitely, I mentioned that I did get one of my masters at Full Sail, and it was called Instructional Design and Technology. And they did the same thing. It was a Launchbox with a computer and a camera and a tripod. And that was so helpful in the degree. I didn't realize how much I was going to use it. And then I still, you know, right in front of me, actually I have that tripod. I still use those materials, even though I got the degree back in 2016. So it's just, you know, that Launchbox is definitely a great asset. So I agree with that.
So what are some things that you do, I guess, like outside of school that I guess that would help you in school, like as an instructor? You do anything that, you know, assist in your work?
No, I try and keep up with the technology side of things, where in the sense of reading articles regarding Microsoft and Excel and the latest developments there. So that's one way that I try and keep in touch, as well as CPA Letter Daily. But that also informs me on tax stuff as well as Excel stuff. But other than that, personally, I know I'm trying to learn the software program Tableau, which is something that on the side, you know, running the tutorials and going through the information, because that does seem to be a shift in the industry that it's heading more and more towards Tableau. So that's one of the ways that I'm working to try and prove myself to then be able to teach better. And because I'll still be teaching Excel as the foundational class, but then now I need to have that familiarity with Tableau in order to prepare the students for how that's going to impact them. And I think eventually we're going to try and get some of it into the curriculum to say, hey, this is what things are going towards right now. So I've tried to keep up on some of the software, I'd say is what I do.
Have you ever thought about like using your students, like just making them create tutorials, like, I don't know, like a bonus assignment?
No, I wouldn't put that torture on them. That would be mean. But then again, also I'm a control freak, so I'm sure that has a little bit something to do with it there. I can't think of any student projects. More so, I enjoy working with students when they do approach me, like if they have a side business and they need suggestions on spreadsheets and stuff. I do enjoy that brainstorming. Or I have had some students that as we go through the month, like especially that week three in the class, which is currently conditional formatting and pivot tables, like, oh man, if I would have known this in my job. And so then I try and talk them, okay, well, how did you deal with this stuff in your job? And get me, you know, the non-confidential part of it and show me what you have going. So then we can explore what might be the best. Because of course, sometimes the way it's taught in class, unless you can see a direct relationship in your job, it can be hard to apply the concepts because it's so surface level. But when students come to me outside of class and say, hey, this is the work project I'm working on, what do you think I can do with this? And then we can brainstorm a little bit more. And that's always really rewarding as well to hear. I learned about pivot tables. Now I think they'd be useful in my job, but I'm not quite sure how. And then we'd talk more about that and figure out where to go from there.
I'm sure that's super helpful for people, because like those are the types of things that you end up paying people to do that, because you don't want to deal with it yourself. You're like,
right.
But ability to, like, you know, pick up those things and know them ahead of time, and being able to, I guess, have somebody like you to, you know, go in behind them, like, hey, is this right? Like, you know, can I help? Or, you know, what can I do to make this better? That's got to help out people tremendously. Has there been somebody who, I guess, had a successful business, that was in your class? You're like, oh, wow, I taught that person. You like found out about it later.
Well, not necessarily a successful business in the sense of an entrepreneur, but somebody that I think has very much been successful in the industry. I don't know if you're familiar with Daniel Dopp, fantasy football. Okay, well, he's with ESPN now, and he has a fantasy football podcast. He's involved with the podcasting for fantasy football, and I had him as a student. And granted, he had already known some Excel, so I don't know how much I taught him that was new, but it was really funny when I heard his voice on TV, and I just stopped for a minute, and I looked back, and I was like, I think that's Daniel Dopp. And then sure enough, his name came up on the screen, and I was like, okay. So he's probably my most famous student, I'd say. But you know, so many people are doing so many great things just in their independent worlds that's what's really the most important part, is that if people are finding success, and what I define as success, like my thing for success, is that you enjoy what you do, regardless of the paycheck or, you know, the people you work with, et cetera. If you love what you're doing and you enjoy going to work every day, that is a success. And I think that I've been lucky enough to come across quite a few people who seem very, very successful.
Yeah. I mean, there's two different, I say there's two different ways of accumulating money. Like, you know, there's, you know, you can create money and then you can, you know, make money. Making money is like, that's what you get. And creating money is, you know, I got this person a job. I got that person a job. So I think that, you know, you, by being an instructor, I tell people all the time, like, I've got friends who, best friends I went to college with, and they were in education. You know, my friend Shelby, she teaches, ooh, she's gonna kill me for this. I think sixth grade. I don't know what grade she teaches. It's, I think that people like that, like our teachers, are definitely underpaid and overstressed because there's so much that they're responsible for. You know, even though they have so much to do, like a limited amount of time to, like, you know, be with these people. That's our future. You know, if whatever a teacher does or says to, you know, this 12-year-old or 8-year-old, you know, there's so many, like, mentally, you know, the teachers are like therapists, and they're moms, they're dads, they're everything. So I definitely have understood the impact of what an instructor, a teacher, professor, whatever, can do for somebody in the future. And like, that's really cool. Like, if I had taught somebody like Daniel and then be like, oh snap, like he's that would have been a really great feeling.
And the one thing that I also have learned over the years is you never know what snippet of information is going to make a difference. In the sense, it's not necessarily, okay, everything you learn in class, but maybe I said this one thing on a completely off topic that somehow impacts you. I mean, that can be very interesting. I know that I have found where I think, oh yeah, my history teacher in high school said this. Now that was one time, and how do I remember that? But obviously it ended up impacting me down the road. And that's what I just think is great about human society in general, is that we can all touch each other's lives in different ways, and you never know how that's going to be with any person that you interact with.
Speaking of that, one of my history teachers in school, he said, but at the end of the day, you can call me anything you want to. You just can't call me lazy. And like, I never thought about, you know, and people say, you know, don't worry about what people call you and whatnot, but I never thought about that. Like, just the fact that nobody, to make it a statement, to say, I'm not lazy, like call me whatever you want to, but except lazy, that's not a bad thing. You know, at the end of the day, it's like, people know whatever you're doing in life, you're going to work hard at it, and that's all you need. That's all. So that was one thing I always remember that he said. But yeah, so is there something that you, I guess, have for people that they should definitely be aware of, like when it comes to going to school, like picking a career, picking a major in school? What is like some tidbit of information you'd have?
My suggestion is explore options. That's just because I didn't know what degree path I was going to go down. I thought police, I thought human resources, I thought accounting, all over the place. So it, first, as best as you can, identify where your passions lie, what's important to you, what are your core values, and then from there, find companies and or workplaces that encourage those core values. That I think also in just in picking even a school, finding a school that matches your personality, best I can say, but where you fit in. You'd said with Full Sail, does like all of a sudden that clicked for you? You liked that fast pace, that worked out well for you. So when deciding whether it be schooling or career path, just any points, try to follow your heart more so than anything else. I mean, yes, obviously finances are a factor that you have to make sure that you can make enough to make ends meet. But if you follow your heart on any given path, it will take you in the right direction of it eventually. It just might be some bumps and bruises along the way. But then again, if you love what you're doing or the subject that you're studying, those bumps and bruises are okay because you're like, I know my end goal, is where I'm going for. So that would be keep your mind open, keep your mind very open as much as possible. I know that's really hard at the moment, in the moment itself. I've been there, oh, well, I'm getting this degree, so I need to do this and I need to do that. And it's like, no, just relax, take a step back. And now that I'm in my late 40s, I can say relax and take a step back because that's what I wish I would have done and I never did.
Yeah, awesome. Well, thank you so much for talking to me and coming on the podcast.
Thanks for your time too.
To some other instructors, because this is really cool. One a person that I think I want to do next is I can't she God, I can't remember her name, but I had
You tell me the subject, I might know who it was.
business law. I just had that.
Business law. Elizabeth Young, probably.
Might have been. I can't remember.
Yeah. Well,
But
I can find out for you because I can look it up and find out who you had. So, but yeah, I'll put you in touch with an instructor if you'd like for sure. Because I'm sure people would enjoy, we love seeing what students are doing, and it was such a pleasure to see you in person too. So that's great.
yeah, I need to get Daniel on the podcast. That's pretty
Right.
Well, thank you for everybody tuning in, and we'll see you next time.